Okay, good morning, everyone. I think we'll make a start. Welcome to the fourth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in this session. Apologies have been received from Joanne Lamont. And today we have one agenda item, consideration of continued petitions. However, today we will be considering 23 continued petitions, some of which are being considered by us for the first time, having been carried over from session four. The first petition is PE1223 on school bus safety. This petition is by Ron Beattie, and members will see we've received submissions from Transport Scotland and the petitioner. This is the longest standing petition we have under consideration. The committee will also see that Transport Scotland recognises Mr. Beattie's contribution in its latest submission, noting various ways in which he's influenced policy on school bus safety. Transport Scotland notes that the UK government is not willing to increase the minimum size of the school bus sign or make overtaking a school bus an offence. Furthermore, the UK government is not minded to devolve the relevant powers, as it has done for seatbelts on school buses. Ultimately, Transport Scotland takes the view that a one-size-fits-all approach to school bus signage is not practical due to the different types of vehicles and settings across Scotland. And as we see from his submission, Mr. Beattie has expressed his disappointment with Transport Scotland's submission. Do members have any suggestions for action?
I think we understand where he's coming from here, but to me it speaks to practicality. And that, to enforce it would be incredibly difficult to do. And I think in its current guise, I think we should close. I've got to be honest.
Okay. Any other views? Sorry.
Yes, Rona McKay. I think I'm minded to agree with my colleague in the sense that I think we've probably taken it as far as it can go, given the Transport Scotland response and the difficulties in actually enforcing what the petitioner wants, although, you know, obviously we understand his good intentions, but I don't think we can take it any further forward, so I would recommend closing.
Okay. We've been joined by Stuart Stevenson, MSP, who's the local member. Mr. Stevenson, would you care to add to the debate?
Thank you very much. I'll do so comparatively briefly in view of your very long list. Mr. Beattie has once again travelled from Gamery. That's a six-hour journey, by the way. So, you know, the continuing engagement with Mr. Beattie in this important subject. I think it's probably the only petition that's been carried forward from session three. So it's a very long-running petition. We have seen some success in Mr. Beattie's previous petition, as the clerk's note tells us, with the seatbelts and school transport bill coming forward. I would simply say a couple of things. First of all, I think that it is actually relatively straightforward, perhaps, to consider taking an approach such as is being taken with the seatbelts bill to enforce different signage via placing a duty on local authorities. I don't necessarily recommend that. That's not where I'm coming from. I'm merely saying that I don't think we should be too deceived by the idea that it would be difficult to do. And it is, I think, previous work has established perfectly legal for the school bus signage to be substantially larger than it currently is. I think the key thing I'd take your attention to as a committee, if I may, convener, is on page 3 of the clerk's note, paragraph 12, which relates to Transport Scotland's submission on the 23rd of February this year, when it's talking about it continues to consider the implications of the Glasgow pilot. Now, pilot in an urban area, of course, may be quite different from what the requirements and the effects might be in a rural area. And Aberdeenshire's pilot, I think, gave us some indication in a different area. But I think the committee might care to consider keeping the petition open until Transport Scotland have provided a substantive response to their following their consideration of the Glasgow pilot. Let me tell the committee the obvious. I know none of the members of the committee who were here when it first came, of course, are now present, that it will cost you a little to keep it on the agenda, at least for that purpose, and I think there would be some benefit in doing that. We are, of course, entirely in the hands of the members of the committee, and it's not a matter which I will have a deliberative input to, but I would encourage you to take that.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Stevenson.
Is there a timescale on when we would get that narrative back?
I'm afraid I don't speak for Transport Scotland. Oh. That's a matter that they would need to address. I think Mr. Beattie's comments to the committee that Transport Scotland's enthusiasm for this is at best comparatively modest may mean that they might need a nudge to bring this to a conclusion of their deliberations. And that might be something the committee might consider doing.
Okay, I think that's reasonable.
Okay, the rest of the committee happy to follow Mr. Stevenson's advice or suggestion?
I think it's reasonable to press Transport Scotland for further clarification. Yeah. You know, given that explanation, I think there'd be no harm in doing that. I think that might. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
I certainly agree with that, Chair. Mm-hmm. Said.
Okay. Having read Mr. Beattie's latest submission, I have to say I can understand his frustration. I think it's well worth approaching Transport Scotland once more. I understand that Mr. Beattie's family have been personally affected by the issues raised by the petition, and as Mr. Stevenson's referred to, he's campaigned tirelessly ever since. So I think perhaps we should approach Transport Scotland once more and see what we get back from them. Everybody agreed?
Yes, agreed.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Mr. Stevenson. Okay, we shall move on now to petition PE1319 on improving youth football in Scotland. This is another long-running petition by Willie Smith and Scott Robertson. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 30th of June, and at that meeting we agreed to take oral evidence on this petition, and arrangements have been made for this to take place. In the meantime, our members content to note the submissions we've received from various footballing bodies, PFA Scotland, the Children and Young People's Commissioner, and the petitioners.
Yes.
Are we?
Yes.
Okay, that's agreed. Thank you. We move on now to petition PE1408 on updating of pernicious anemia, vitamin B12 deficiency, understanding and treatment. This petition is by Andrea MacArthur and concerns the method of diagnosing pernicious anemia. Members have a clerk's note and submissions from the petitioner and the Scottish Government. It's noted in the papers that progress was made by the Scottish Haematology Society on developing a draft summary document for use in the Scottish practice setting. However, the Scottish Haematology Society has now withdrawn from the process, and it's not clear how the draft summary document is being taken forward. Do members have any comments or suggestions on what action we may wish to take in this petition?
Why did they withdraw, do we know?
Okay, I believe it was an issue with resources.
Okay. So does that mean the draft summary document is no longer going to be continued?
I'm not sure. Clearly, you know, there is a bit of uncertainty here. So I think we need to write to the Minister for Public Health asking for clarification of the status of the draft summary document and whether it will be published.
Okay. Agreed.
Is that agreed course of action?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, we'll move on now to petition PE1458 on a register of interest for members of Scotland's judiciary. This petition is by Peter Cherby and calls for the establishment of a register of interest for members of Scotland's judiciary. Members will have seen the note by the clerk and submissions from the petitioner and Professor Patterson. Members will also be aware of further information that was provided by Mr. Cherby in respect of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and the Judicial Complaints Reviewer. The action called for in Mr. Cherby's petition received support from a number of MSPs in the last session of Parliament, but neither the Scottish Government or the Lord President, both current and former, support the introduction of such a register. Do members have any views on what we may wish to do with this petition?
I basically, having read this, don't think that the opening of the proposed register would be the worst thing, but since the views of those that decide are set, the motion should be closed.
Okay. Any other views?
Yeah, I mean, I have, you know, sympathy with Mr. Cherby, and I actually do think that there should be a register, but I'm just not sure how much further we can take this, or what road we could go down to progress it.
Clearly, I have some background to this. There was a debate in the previous session in the chamber, and the petition did receive quite a bit of support from members across the chamber. Now, we had the former Lord President, Lord Gill, in to give evidence. I know we've had a submission from the current Lord President, Lord Carloway, who is basically opposed to the suggestion. However, I would be interested to ask if he would be keen to come in and give oral evidence to back up his earlier submission. I also note Professor Alan Patterson's comments and criticisms in relation to the perceived inadequacies in the current recusals register. Therefore, it could be helpful to take oral evidence from Professor Patterson as well. And I also note from Mr. Cherby's suggestion that we should invite the Judicial Complaints Reviewer, Gillian Thompson, to give her thoughts on proposals to create a register of judicial interests. However, we have already taken oral evidence from her in session 4 on this petition, and therefore I'm unsure as to whether her view has changed, and her view was that there should be a register. So on these points, would members be interested in hearing from Lord Carloway and Professor Patterson, or are you still of the view that it should be closed?
I think the petition is not unreasonable. I would be quite keen to.
I'd be keen to explore it further to hear evidence. Yeah.
I'm happy with that, I think, because
I'm sorry. Yes, it's a big subject. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah. We can ask the Lord President if he is prepared to come in and give evidence. Mm-hmm. There was a difficulty in having the previous Lord President in, so we'll see if he's willing to do that. Failing that, we'll just have to revert to the written submission that he. Mm-hmm. He gave us, but is that a agreed course of action?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll move on now to petition PE 1463 on effective thyroid and adrenal testing, diagnosis and treatment. And we've been joined by Elaine Smith, MSP, who has been campaigning vociferously on this issue for some time. This is a petition by Lorraine Cleaver on the diagnosis and treatment of thyroid and adrenal conditions. As members will be aware, the Scottish Government commissioned Thyroid UK to conduct a patient survey that was to form a listening exercise. The results of the survey were published last year, and following this, the Session 4 Public Petitions Committee held an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health and her officials to discuss the survey results. Members will see in the meeting papers an update from the Scottish Government dated 2nd of August 2016. The Scottish Government advises that Scottish data cannot be extrapolated from the survey results, and we wrote to the Scottish Government to ask what action it will take to address the issues raised by the survey results, and a clear answer has not been provided so far. We've received a number of submissions expressing disappointment with the Scottish Government's response, including from Thyroid UK and the petitioner. Do members have any comments? Perhaps we should hear from Elaine Smith.
That would be useful, yes. Thank you very much, convener. I don't know where to start, to be honest. Possibly with John Midgley, because I think the submission you have from John Midgley goes through the letter from the government and basically tears a lot of holes in it. It asks huge amounts of questions. It questions a lot of the answers that you have received. You know, he talks about things like illogical arguments being made. Under recommendation 5, he talks about the need for more research, and he also talks about you know, studies being fatally flawed, and he goes on to explain why. So I think when you read through Dr. Midgley's response, that's hugely interesting. Recommendation 9, actually, he says that leading US scientists, Dr. Bianco and Dr. John Glass of the US, have publicly expressed their doubts as to the appropriateness of the uniform use of thyroxine monotherapy and have questioned currently held positions against combined therapy in a significant proportion of patients. And, you know, I think a lot of this, it's been going on for 5 years, as you know, but I think a lot of this is about entrenched opinions in the medical profession, and that's quite worrying. I went to a meeting in Edinburgh on Wednesday night where an endocrinologist addressed a packed room, and the room, of course, was packed with women, because this is also primarily something, as we know, that affects women. The men in the room happened to be the endocrinologist and a man who was there with his daughter, who was only well and functioning because she was getting her medicine, desiccated thyroid hormone, from Thailand. Now, we shouldn't in 21st century Scotland be having women having to go on the internet to source medicine that's bringing them back from the dead, and I'm not being dramatic about that. I've been there myself. You know, they're having to source it from Thailand or America or wherever. I just think that's pretty unacceptable. So, the other thing that the women that night said to me was they really felt strongly that because it was a woman's problem, primarily, it was not getting the attention that otherwise it might have. So sorry to the men in the room, but that was the considered opinion at that meeting. Hugely interesting things were said. The endocrinologist there was quite open-minded, had his own views on certain things, but certainly open-minded about combined therapy with T3. Doesn't feel he could, I'm not going to name his names, but he doesn't feel he could prescribe desiccated thyroid hormone because of the current status with that. There was actually a woman in the room who was on desiccated thyroid hormone as a child. It was only taken away as a treatment, if you remember, in the 80s. And she has never felt well since her treatment was changed. She remembers feeling well on her desiccated thyroid hormone. So I think you've also got another submission from Professor Rudolf Herrmann, who also is an endocrinologist for more than 30 years. And, you know, I think that's a really interesting submission that he has put into you as well. And at the end of it, what he says is, I would expect less lecturing from an outdated knowledge base and more awareness for the undeniable existence and magnitude of the issues. At the very least, patients and doctors alike should not be unnecessarily and unreasonably restricted in the treatment options. And that seems to me to be the bottom line. On Wednesday night, we also heard that desiccated thyroid hormone was one of the very first ever actual medical treatments, which is something that I didn't even know. And so I would really like to put a plea to you as a committee. Perhaps you've got a whole host of information. You've got patient stories direct from the horse's mouth, if you like. Perhaps it might be something that Spice could pull together, because there's a whole lot of medical information too supporting the petition. So maybe Spice might be able to pull something together, looking at, for instance, Dr. Midgley, looking at the government and taking out the bits where there's contradictory evidence, just put together a paper for the committee on all of this, taking some of the patient experiences as well. And maybe you could then decide what sort of action you would want to take beyond that. I mean, personally for me, after all this time and with all the evidence that seems to have been unfolding over the 5 years, I would be extremely
keen, and I'm sure the petitioner would, that if the committee would consider a short inquiry. I know your work, I don't know what your workload is like, I'm sure it's very, very busy, but it has been a really interesting petition for the committee. It's unveiled a whole host of issues, and so that would be something that I would be keen on. Beyond that, if you were going to take evidence again from the Minister for Public Health, then perhaps Dr. John Midgley as well, if you were just going to do even a one-off evidence session. But actually, if you were to hear yourself personally from some of the women who've been affected by this and their lives have been affected, I think that would add very much to this whole process. Actually, we talk about preventative medicine. If we could get the treatment for thyroid disorders correct, then actually we would make real savings in the NHS. You know, you would make savings on things like fertility treatment, and there would be savings on issues like people being put on antidepressants when actually it's the thyroid medicine that's wrong. You know, the list is endless. And also, you could bring people back to... back into the economy, because at the moment there are many people who just frankly can't function because their medicine isn't right, and that's a bit of a scandal, I think. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I mean, clearly you feel extremely passionate about this issue, and you know, it certainly opened my eyes to learn of the predicament that the petitioners and others find themselves in. I've stated previously in this committee, it's beyond me why desiccated thyroid treatment isn't available in this country, and particularly when you consider that it was available in the 80s. So how do members feel with regard to Ms. Smith's suggestions? Clearly, a more detailed paper from SPICE would certainly not go wrong.
I agree entirely with what Elaine was saying, and I would, you know, I would want to, as a first stage, get a balanced, detailed paper from SPICE for our information. But I would then like to go on, as Elaine suggests, and have a proper inquiry into it, because it's far too important not to explore it even further.
It seems to be dragging on, and that's 5 years. Mm-hmm. I think if we're going to move this on, let's actually agree with the paper in SPICE. But I would really like to have the sides in the chamber, and you know, if we're going to move it on properly, interrogate it, because otherwise it's just going to keep dragging on and dragging on, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I think the best course of action is to ask SPICE for more details, and then ask the clerks to draw up a paper looking at the options with regard to a mini inquiry, and also options with regard to taking oral evidence, possibly again, well, from the Minister for Public Health and possibly from Dr. Midgley. So we'll expect a paper back on this, and we can take a further decision on that at a later date, but hopefully sooner rather than later. Is that agreeable?
Yes. And Dr. Rudolf Hellman as well, the two.
As an option for...
Yeah, as well.
Okay, if the clerks can take that away, we can hopefully move on this pretty quickly. Okay, thanks.
Can I stay for another petition?
Of course, feel free. Yeah. Okay, we'll move on now to petition PE1480. On Alzheimer's and dementia awareness, and petition PE1533 on abolition of non-residential social care charities for older and disabled people. These petitions have been brought by Amanda Coppell and Jeff Adamson, respectively. Both petitions relate to aspects of social care charging. Do members have any suggestions for action? Okay, suggestion for action is to write to the Cabinet Secretary. Are we agreed on that course of action?
We haven't had any submission from Cabinet Secretary yet.
No. No, there's nothing so far. Okay. Okay, agreed. Okay, thank you. Right, we'll move on to petition PE1517 on polypropylene mesh medical devices. This petition has been brought by Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy on behalf of Scottish Mesh Survivors. The Chief Medical Officer has provided an update on the SIMS trial, and MHRA has provided information on completed and ongoing projects. This includes the interim report published in October last year by the Independent Review Team. The expert group's work is ongoing, and in carrying this petition over, our predecessor committee suggested that the petition should be considered again once the final report of the Independent Review is published. Do members have any comments on that suggestion? I think perhaps we should defer further consideration of the petition until the final report of the Independent Review is published.
I would agree. I think we'll have to see that report, yeah.
Mm-hmm. However, we could consider writing to the Scottish Government to seek an update on the work of the expert group.
Yes, absolutely.
Is that agreed? Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Agreed. This is another one that has been dragging on for quite some time. Okay, we now move on to petition 1540. Sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself here. Our next petition was lodged by Douglas Filland and calls for a permanent solution to be found for the issues experienced on the A83 at the Rest and Be Thankful. The issues relate to the closure of that section of the A83 following landslips on the hillside beside the roadway. Members have submissions from Transport Scotland and the petitioner, as well as a note from the clerk. So do we have any views on what further action we should take?
Detailed knowledge, Chair, about this. I think what the suggestion of writing the Minister of Transport in Ireland is an appropriate action to take. There are clear solutions to this, one of which is to move the road to the south side of Glen Crow, which I know is an option that was already brought forward before to the Parliament. But I think there has been the biggest problem is really the economic impact into Argyll and Bute, because it is a main artery in there. And I think clearly what's coming from the petitioners, and as I read it, and indeed as I know on the ground, is this clear thing, a permanent solution. It's no use trying to patch up. So I think we need to accept the fact that writing to Minister of Transport now is asking for confirmation, etc. That paragraph I would seem appropriate to be done at this stage, because they're still on information gathering. There are still consultation groups meeting in Arica Town Hall, Village Hall, to go through this. So there has been an active participation by the government in trying to come to solution to this, and I think it'd be fair to let this review go forward.
Okay.
I think the review should go forward as well. I just wanted to ask my colleague, the 6.6 million investment, is that regarded as not a permanent solution,
or yes, is that? The problem is the geological nature of the issue, and the worry is every time there is a landslide, the nets get strained and they have to be renewed. And we're talking of hundreds of thousands of pounds, and we just feel that it's money, dare I say, down the drain. And there's and I can see the problem with that. And there is a fear sometimes of people going up that road. I mean, I've travelled it many times, as we all know. And I think the disappointing thing, there is a permanent solution. And we're getting close to the fact that the money spent on the temporary solution is getting very close to option B, which is there. And I hope the review will address that. And that's why I think it should be looked at in that way.
OK, thank you. It's good to get some local insight into the issue. Just to clarify, are we agreed to write to the Minister for Transport?
Yes.
And the islands asking for confirmation of the timing of the review of the National Transport Strategy and the Strategic Transport Projects Review, and how the issues affecting the wider communities of Argyll and Bute.
It's a bigger issue than just simply repairing it. This is the problem.
Yeah. Okay, so we're agreed on that course of action.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move on now to petition PE1545 on residential care provision for the severely learning disabled. This petition is by Anne Maxwell on behalf of the Muir Maxwell Trust. Members will see from the papers that we've received two submissions from the Scottish Government. Since the petition was lodged, the Scottish Government has consulted with the petitioner and committed to funding a project to improve data collection on the demand for residential care. It has also launched a project to identify suitable alternatives to out-of-area placement in Scotland. The Scottish Government has been engaging with the petitioner on these projects and provided a two-year project plan. And I'm sure members will join with me in welcoming the Scottish Government's engagement with the petitioner on these issues. Do you have any suggestions for the way forward?
Well, I note that the 2 years was up in March 2017. Mm-hmm. And it seemed reasonable to wait until that's completed and see that report.
That's just the first stage of the two-year project. So, you prefer to defer further consideration until after that point? How do the other members feel?
I think that would be sensible until we actually see the report, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay, that's fine.
I would agree with that.
Mm. Okay, we'll go with postponing further consideration until March 2017, when the first stage of the two-year project should have been completed under the timeframe proposed by the Scottish Government. But at this point, can I thank the petitioner, Anne Maxwell, for the significant amount of work that she has put in by bringing this petition to Parliament. And it's good to know the Scottish Government has engaged positively with the petitioner. Okay, if we can move on now to petition PE1563 on sewage sludge spreading. This petition was brought forward by Doreen Goldie on behalf of Avonbridge and Stanburn Community Council and relates to the use of sewage sludge on land. The Scottish Government's position on the issue raised by the petition has not changed in recent months, and it's confirmed its commitment to improving existing legislation. The petitioner in turn has expressed her disappointment with the Scottish Government's position. I should declare a local interest, as I've previously been dealing with the petitioners and some other local residents for a considerable period of time on this issue. Do members have any views as to whether there's anything more that we as a committee could do at this stage, given that the government has a clear approach in mind in terms of strengthening the regulatory framework?
I think we've come to the end of the road with it, but I think a letter to the petitioner expressing the concerns to the government would still be in order.
Okay, is that agreed?
Yes, I agree with
everyone.
Yeah.
Okay, it has to be said that the petition has been partially successful in that it encouraged the Scottish Government to undertake the sewage sludge review earlier this year. And action has been taken locally to address a number of the issues that had been raised. However, it would seem that the petition has been partially successful, but I think we have taken it as far as we can go with regard to what the powers this committee has. So are we agreed to close the petition?
Yes.
Brian?
Yeah, OK. I can't think of anything else.
Okay. Perhaps it would be an idea to remind the petitioner, as I think Rona referred to, that the rules around bringing back issues there's a rule that you have to wait a year before you can take a petition back. However, if progress hasn't happened, the petitioners may well wish to do that in the future. Okay, if we can move on to petition PE1568 on funding, access and promotion of the NHS CIC. This petition was lodged by Catherine Hughes amid concerns over the provision of services at the Centre for Integrative Care. We've received correspondence from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, which indicates its plans for the public engagement strategy in relation to its current proposals. Erin Campbell, Minister for Public Health and Sport, confirmed in her correspondence of the 26th of July that designation of a centre or facility as a national resource is not a matter for the Scottish Government. She confirmed recently during a member's business debate that the public engagement on the proposals will run from September until November. Members will also note that the proposals on the CIC are part of a wider number of proposals made by NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and which have been subject to discussion and debate in the Parliament as recently as yesterday afternoon. Do members have any views on what actions we might wish to take with this petition?
Yeah, we'd be referring to the other committees and see what they're doing about the work on this particular issue. The Health and Sport Committee.
It would be Health and Sport Committee.
Yes, I mean, sorry, it's Health and Sport Committee.
Yeah. Okay. Elaine Smith stayed for this petition specifically, so can I ask Elaine to contribute?
Thanks very much, Convener. I suppose there's a slight update on the petition because it was part of the motion that was passed in Parliament yesterday, which asked for the government to call in certain proposals, and the CIC was in fact one of those that was mentioned. But of course, it's up to the government to decide how they want to take that forward. There is also a meeting tomorrow at 3:30 in the Old York Hill Hospital for MSPs who are interested in the issue. So I know that some MSPs are going to go along to that. Certainly I'm going to go along to that. So there might be some information comes out of that that might be useful for the committee. Personally, I'm slightly confused because I did think that it was a specialist national hospital. I think a lot of people did think that. And I think the committee maybe had some evidence in the past indicating that that was the case. It's certainly a hospital that receives referrals from all over Scotland, or it did until NHS boards started to seem to be cutting back on those referrals. So, and now it seems to be that the government are saying that it's not a national service or a national resource. And on your paper that you have, the government are saying a highly specialised clinical service may be considered for national designation through application to the National Specialist Service Committee. But personally, I'm not very clear who would make that application. You know, would it be the health board that runs it, or would it be the government that makes that application? I think there's some questions around that. So I think it has been viewed as a national resource. The petitioners are very passionate about the service because it does seem to have very good outcomes with patients who've maybe reached the end of their treatment and there isn't anywhere else to go. So the inpatient service is highly valued, and actually it's got extraordinarily high patient satisfaction ratings. So personally, I think if something's working, why would we be trying to change it? I can understand if things are not working, then obviously change may be necessary. So I'll just put in, it's just some information that I'm giving you. I mean, it's clearly up to yourselves what you want to do with the actual petition. But I think that's just some further information I wanted to impart to the committee.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much. That's helpful. Are there any other comments from the members?
It's difficult to know quite how to deal with it because it's part of the health board review and it's ongoing. We're right in the middle of it. I see no harm in referring the petition to the Health and Sport Committee. I think that would, be one action we could take. I don't see the point in writing to the Health Board for an overview of its engagement strategy because you know the predicted response you'll get back. That would be my view, I think, because it's ongoing. We just need to, but there would be absolutely no harm in writing to the Health and Sport Committee.
Elaine Smith raises some valid and salient points, and I think rather than defer the petition and delay it even longer with the Public Petitions Committee, given that the Health and Sport Committee are they are working on the strategic plan and vision 2016 to 2021. Mm-hmm. I think there's a strong argument to refer it to that committee as soon as possible. Mm-hmm. Is everyone agreed?
Agreed. Absolutely. Agreed. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, we move on now to petition PE1577 on adult cerebral palsy services. This petition is by Rachel Wallace. Members will see we've received a submission from the petitioner, and it would seem an appropriate point in the new session to ask the Scottish Government whether it is minded to introduce or consult on a national clinical pathway for adults with cerebral palsy. I understand the petitioner considers it is important that NHS professionals and other stakeholders are consulted on this issue. Do members have any views?
I think it's entirely reasonable to have a set out pathway, a clinical pathway. I think it's entirely reasonable, and I think that I would be in mind to write to the Scottish Government to see where they sit on this.
I would agree with that. Yes, I think we should.
Find out before we can really take that forward.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're agreed to write the Scottish Government to ask whether it's minded to introduce or consult on a national clinical pathway for adults with cerebral palsy, and to consult with NHS professionals and other stakeholders on this issue. Agreed?
Yes, agreed.
Okay, thank you. If we can move on now to petition PE1581 on Save Scotland's school libraries. This petition was lodged by Duncan Wright on behalf of Save Scotland School Libraries. Members will see that we've recently received submissions from author Theresa Breslin, the Chartered Institute of Library and Information Professionals in Scotland, Literature Alliance Scotland, as well as from the petitioner, in which he refers to the open letter sent from Gruffalo author Julia Donaldson, expressing concerns about the provision of school librarian services. Each of the submissions suggests that the changes run contrary to initiatives to support and promote literacy and to make reading fun and an integral part of the curriculum. I welcome members' views on this petition.
Again, being of a certain age, I just think it seems logical to have a school library. I think we should have a national framework that's across the whole of the country. And I don't see why that wouldn't be the case. So I'm of the opinion that it's certainly something worth pursuing.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely vital to pursue. I think it's an incredibly important part of the education system. And a couple of actions I would want to take would be to write to the government to ask whether there's been any change in the position since last December, and also to refer the petition to the Education and Skills Committee to consider it in a wider context.
I don't think we can do both at this point.
You can't do both.
Yeah, I mean, we would have to seek an update from the Scottish Government and then consider
That's fine.
I think we have to get that, because one of the problems is the local authorities are taking different views on this. Yeah. There's different amount of issues on the last running of the budgets. And I know in my particular area it was an issue, a big issue, on the islands. And I think, as my colleague says quite rightly, and Rona, I think we should find where they stand, the Scottish Government.
I mean, education is sort of devolved to the local, local government. So,
mm-hmm.
I'd be interested to see. I'd be interested to see what the Scottish Government's guidance would be to that to local government.
Mm-hmm. It would be good to see that before we take.
Can I come in, Chair? I think the issue is, I think it's a wider remit than just local authorities. I think it's got to take into all concerns and how the education system has been programmed, and therefore the part played by research and librarians and things like that, and I think that's important. So we can only get that by going the route we're suggesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to seek information or a further update from the Scottish Government as to whether their position has changed since December 2015. I think it would be also useful to seek the views of the Scottish Library and Information Council at the same time, and then when it comes back to committee, we can look at further options.
Sure.
Yes, okay. Agreed. Agreed. Okay, thank you. If we can move on now to petition PE1586 on statutory control measures for invasive non-native species. This petition is by James Mackey on behalf of Innes Community Council. Members will note we've received submissions from SEPA and the petitioner. This petition seeks to create statutory powers to force landowners to destroy invasive non-native species that grow on their private property. The Session 4 Public Petitions Committee sought the views of a number of stakeholders, many of whom considered the existing legislation provides adequate powers to address the issue raised by the petition. Stakeholders also supported a coordinated approach to invasive non-native species management rather than a piecemeal one. And SEPA provided additional information in its submission dated the 12th of May of this year. This explained who leads research into biocontrols and the level of funding that's been set aside for relevant projects. SEPA also explained that it operates a 24-hour helpline for members of the public. Do members have any views on what action we should take with regard to this petition?
I'd be inclined to follow the advice of the Scottish Wildlife Trust and SEPA, who are the experts in this field, and have, you know, given their response. I don't think there's really any. I would want to close this petition. I don't think there's any point keeping it going.
Yeah, we agreed to close the petition.
Yes, I think there's sufficient legislation advice in place already for the council authorities, for example, to deal with it. The issue is actually down to enforcing that. It's one of enforcement that is the issue.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Well, can I thank the petitioner for bringing this petition to the Parliament? I have to say, as a member of the Scottish Parliament's Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, I can understand Mr Mackey's and the Innes Community Council's frustration with regard to invasive non-native species. However, as Mr Corrie said, I think enforcement is the answer, and we look forward to local authorities using these powers. Okay, if we can move on to petition PE1591 on major redesign of healthcare services in Skye, Lough Alsh and South West Ross. We're joined by Rhoda Grant, presumably for this petition, and we'll hear from Rhoda shortly. This petition was lodged by Katrina MacDonald on behalf of SOS NHS and is continued from the Session 4 Committee's consideration. We've two submissions from the petitioner included within the meeting papers, which follow responses provided to our predecessor committee from the Scottish Health Council and NHS Highland. The petitioner provided her most recent submission following publication of the initial agreement on the plans for modernisation of the services and argues that this is based on a flawed economic appraisal. We have some options for consideration. I can open up to members.
I would like to hear from Rhoda and okay, what options there are, because it's, you know, it's new to me. So,
okay, over to you, Rhoda.
Yes, I mean, this is quite a difficult situation because, as you will see from the petition, people are really concerned about the service redesign. It's been ongoing for quite a number of years. The Health Board made this proposal a number of years ago. The community weren't happy, and the Health Board went back to full consultation with the community. And I think the community are totally agreed that there should only be one hospital in Skye, and neither of the hospitals that are there at the moment are fit for purpose. And indeed, we're losing services from Skye going back to Inverness, so people are having to travel further while we consider this. So there is an argument that the hospital needs to be built sooner rather than later to get services back into Skye. But that doesn't, I suppose, negate from the real concerns that the people in the north of Skye have, because the proposal is to build the new hospital in Broadford, which covers parts of West Ross as well. So it's for more than Skye. And they have real concerns about emergency care. They have concerns which are replicated throughout, indeed, the Highlands and Islands, about travel for non-emergency care to clinics and the like. There is not good public transport. And poor weather, the patient transport service really doesn't work in that area. So people without access to their own transport, I think, are rightly concerned about how they'd access the hospital in Broadford, and also about palliative and elderly care, which is provided in Portree at the moment. So I think there's a number of issues. And I think while we all recognise we need to move ahead and quickly with building a hospital to allow people to access care, more specialist care locally, I think there is also an issue about the health board speaking and, you know, listening to the community needs and planning with them. Now, that's been difficult because they've been at loggerheads for, you know, a period of time, and to try and bring them together to actually say what can we have instead, and to build services that actually meet the needs of the community, I think is something that's been missing. Now, I know there's ongoing working groups, but I would want to see the health board involve people from the north of Skye very much in those and try and bring them in. Now, that might, the health board argue with me that they have tried to do that, the community don't feel that that has happened adequately. So I guess I'm not giving you any answers, but anything you could do to try and keep bring the health board and the community together around the table to look at how they design services that will cover all the needs of all the people, and to make sure that people, and it might involve getting the Scottish Ambulance Service involved as well about transport to the hospital, to make sure that there is adequate cover for people and that there's emergency cover, because again, it's the Scottish Ambulance Service that provide emergency cover. So I think they have a role in this as well as looking at what could be delivered from Portree that would save people travelling, because we all want healthcare as close to home as possible.
You've heard from one of the local members. Have you any further comments or suggestions?
When I read this one, you know, I mean, it does look like there's a bit of an impasse here, and you know, I was trying to understand what we as a committee can do for this. I mean, I was inclined to look at it as a possibility of taking oral evidence, quite frankly, on this one. But as a committee, you know, just to try and understand more. In this particular situation, but it's like, what can we do as a committee here? Because, you know, it's certainly not something you want to leave, in my opinion. I mean, we could write to the government, I suppose, and sort of get an update on their position on it. But it does seem something, because when a decision like this is made, it's made. You know, one of the things that struck me with what you were saying there was the ambulance service, for sure, would be able to give you a really good analysis of the issues that they feel there are on that. Perhaps, Chair, you could let us know realistically, as a committee, can we achieve here?
Well, there would be nothing to stop us taking oral evidence, however. I think there's a strong argument to write to, well, certainly to keep the petition open, and to write to the Scottish Government to ask whether it would reconsider the decision to approve the redesign in light of the economic analysis that's been received from Professor MacDonald, and also to take on board Rhoda Grant's suggestion that we write to the Scottish Ambulance Service. I don't think we've had their view previously. No. So, given the request from Rhoda Grant and the fact that there are previous examples of ministers overturning approved major service changes following reviews by independent scrutiny panels, I think it's worth one further attempt and to perhaps ask the Scottish Government what their view would be on setting up an independent scrutiny panel to look at it.
Chair, can I come in?
No, go.
Yeah, I've just stepped down as chair of the IJB for Argyll and Bute, and we've had exactly the same situation in Mull. And all I can say is I commend exactly what you're saying. I think we need to, it's about engagement with the community, and we need to engage with the Scottish Ambulance Service, and this is on the Rossmore, that was the northwest end of it, and obviously make sure that the redesign proposals are actually conveyed to the community and understood, and then the adjustments have been made, because we had it right back to ministerial level. And lessons, lots of lessons were learned, and I would not want that to happen in the sky. So I think it needs to be explored further, engaging with the agencies and the people, mainly the people, as to what is going to be logistic. And I think the key issue was, what I experienced was, people were not able to get to the facilities because they didn't drive into a car, they're up a glen, and we have to consider that as a very important issue, that it actually is accessible. We did it, we got there. But it was a bit of mind-bending and hard work, and I fully understand where you're coming from. So I commend the Mull experience.
Mull and Skye are two areas of the world that I know quite well, so I'm certainly aware of the issues, yeah. Okay, so are we agreed to take this forward right to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Ambulance Service, and then look at further options after we hear back from them? Okay, right, thanks very much. Thank you, Rhoda Grant, for attending. Okay, if we can move on now to petition PE1592 on Group B strep information and testing. This petition is by Shaheen McQuaid, and members will see from the papers that the National Screening Committee is reviewing the evidence on Group B strep at the moment. Do members have suggestions for what action we should take?
Well, again, seeing here that there's a review of evidence on Group B strep screening is due, perhaps it would be realistic to wait till that evidence is delivered.
Yeah. I agree. I think we need to wait until that evidence is published.
Absolutely, we can't take a decision until we've seen that.
No. Okay, it's agreed to delay further consideration of the petition until the National Screening Committee's review of the evidence on Group B strep screening is published. Agreed?
Yes.
Agreed. Okay, thank you. If we can move on now to petition PE1593 on a full review of the Offensive Behaviour at Football and Threatening Communications Scotland Act 2012. This petition was brought forward by Paul Quigley on behalf of Fans Against Criminalisation, and since the petition was considered last session, James Kelly, MSP, has launched a proposal for a members' bill that would give effect to what the petition calls for. So, as members will note, the consultation period on that proposal runs until October. So, do members wish to do anything further on this petition at this point, or should we defer further consideration of the petition until it becomes clear whether Mr. Kelly's proposals will go on to be lodged as a bill?
Defer.
Yes, definitely defer.
Okay, agreed to defer. Thank you. Move on now to petition PE1595 on a moratorium on shared space schemes. The petitioner for this petition is Sandy Taylor. His petition calls for a moratorium on shared space schemes until all safety issues have been addressed. In particular, Mr. Taylor has concerns about the impact that schemes of this type have on the ability of the blind and visually impaired people, as well as vulnerable pedestrians, to be able to safely access the places where they are introduced. This is the first time the committee has considered this petition, and members will note the submissions we've received from Mr. Taylor, Margaret Hutchison and Sarah Gayton. Do members have any comments on what action we may take?
Can I declare an interest in this petition? This petitioner is from my constituency, and I've been backing his campaign and do back his campaign from the start. So I'm well aware of the issues surrounding this petition. Do you want me to say what action I think we should take now? I would be very keen to have the Minister for Transport provide evidence at a future meeting on the whole issue. And I would also like the petition referred to the Equalities Commission, because the petitioner states quite clearly that, you know, this is a breach of the human rights of the less able in the community who feel effectively barred from their own town. The design of this shared space initiative in Kirkintilloch is entirely unsuitable, and it's caused a huge amount of public anger.
Okay, thank you. Can I just clarify with the clerks where we would be with regard to inviting the minister to give evidence and also simultaneously referring it to the Equalities Committee? Equalities Commission Committee.
It's one or the other. Oh, whatever is most going to be most effective.
Well, we could hear from the minister first, and then you would have the option of referring it to the Equalities Committee after that.
That would be fine.
I think, Chair, I'll just say there was an article on television last night exactly about this issue in the place called Poynton, and all these points, as Ren was saying, and what's in here have come out, and I think it's absolutely right approach to take the way we're suggesting the minister.
Agreed for that course of action then. So we look forward to hearing from the Minister at a future date. Okay, we'll move on to petition PE1598 on protecting wild salmonids from sea lice from Scottish salmon farms. This petition is by Guy Linley Adams on behalf of Salmon and Trout Conservation Scotland. Members will see from the papers we've received a number of submissions. What action do members think we should take?
I think the more I've read about this, the more concerned I'm becoming. And I think one of the questions we asked in the last petition, the last time it was in, when there was an oral petition, was that we asked that when they were in the treatment of lice and salmon, actually killed all the crustaceans in the area as well. So it speaks to ecology for me, and I think, you know, I'm certainly of a mind that we should be taking this forward quite robustly, because I know there are other ways of dealing with this. The introduction of, I think it's RAS, into a more ecological way of dealing with it. And I would like to know an awful lot more about this, because I do think it's obviously a major industry for us in Scotland, but wild salmon also, if it's going to affect the wild salmon and other crustaceans in the delivery of the eradication of sea lice, the way it's currently done, it does concern me.
Okay. Well, as a previous member of the RACI committee, we put through the Aquaculture Bill in 2013, and we were on site and we saw RAS up in Loch Abar. It seemed to be a good remedy to the issue. Would members feel it would be appropriate to refer this to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, understanding Rule 15.6.2, to allow them to look into this subject in more detail, rather than the Petition Committee prolonging it?
Yeah, I think so, because they've got the bigger picture and the effect on the rural economy, Chair, and I think that's a quite appropriate action to take.
We're agreed to forward it to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Okay, thank you. And can I thank the petitioner for bringing this issue to the attention of the Petitions Committee. Okay, can we move on now to petition PE1600 on speed awareness courses. This petition has been brought by John Chapman. We've received responses from I Am Road Smart, which was previously the Institute of Advanced Motorists, at the RACC and the Scottish Government. Each response acknowledges the potential merits of what the petition suggests, but notes that any such courses would require the approval of the Lord Advocate. Do members have any views on this petition?
It'd be interesting to see what the Lord Advocate himself said on the petition, I think. If it requires his approval.
Option. Chair, because obviously it's a legal issue that's currently in statute and how they deal with it, and so it's a major change.
Okay. So Are we agreed that we'll write to the Lord Advocate's office seeking its views on the petition and its concerns about the effectiveness of speed awareness courses?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on now to petition PE1601 on European beavers in Scotland. This petition is by Andy Miles, and members will see from the papers that the Scottish Government expects to make a decision on the issue raised by the petition by the end of the year. Are there any comments from members on this petition?
It really should be referred to the Environmental, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee because it's, again, a bigger issue. It's the balance of nature, shall we say, and the cause and effect. And I think it's really out with this, but I mean, we noted, but I think it needs to be passed on to them for some consideration.
Okay. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Yes, agreed.
Okay. It struck me, I think I mentioned this at the last committee, it struck me that the decision on this has been imminent for about 6 months. So we look forward to seeing a decision soon. And in the meantime, we'll refer the petition to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. Okay, thank you. And the final petition to consider today is PE1602 on ECGs and heart echo tests within antenatal care. The final petition on the agenda, as I say, is by Carol Sunnox, and submissions have been received from the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists, the Nursing Midwifery Council, and the Scottish Government. You may wish to note that these responses say about current work that's underway in relation to PPCM. So, do we have any views on this petition?
Well, I note that they're looking at bits of a good practice guide on cardiac disease and pregnancy. I note that that's due. It looks to me that can we write to them with a request for indicative timescales on that. With that, I see that seems.
Yes, I think so. I think it's hugely important, but it's, and you know, the petitioner has highlighted the importance of this, and the Scottish Government have acknowledged it. So I think we wait till we see further publications on the issue from the Good Practice Guide, and keep the petition open and just keep gathering more evidence.
Okay, I think we're all agreed that we should write to the appropriate agencies to seek updates or indicative timescales for the publication of the Good Practice Guide on Cardiac Disease and Pregnancy, and take further action once we have heard back. That agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much. That brings us to the end of the proceedings. Thank you very much to the members of the committee and also to the MSPs who have attended to give further submissions. Thank you. I close the meeting.